everybody. This is a most unusual night again at Politics in the Pub. I'm Cathy Vogan, Politics in the Pub committee member. I'm a lecturer in film and communications. I've worked in IT. I've worked as a journalist with WikiLeaks for a few years. And I have a strong interest in what's going on in terms of tech. The first thing I want to show you is just a little bit of background. So Cambridge Analytica may boast both the Trump and Brexit victories. Now, I don't know if you heard Hillary Clinton speaking on Monday night. She didn't mention them. And she did mention Assange.
He's a tool of Russian intelligence. And if he's such a martyr of free speech, why doesn't WikiLeaks ever publish anything coming out of Russia?
We have published over 800,000 documents of various kinds that relate to Russia. Most of those are critical.
And Pizzagate. Have you all heard of Pizzagate?
There was a concerted operation between WikiLeaks and Russia and most likely people in the United States to make up stories, outlandish, often terrible stories.
ISIS is created largely with money from the very people who are giving money to the Clinton Foundation.
Yes.
And the worst example was something called Pizzagate.
You'll be hearing a little about it here. But in fact, Cambridge Analytica did a hell of a lot for both the Trump campaign and the Brexit campaign. You will hear of Alexander Nix, the CEO of Cambridge Analytica, but first of all, you're going to hear from Dr. Michael Kaczynski.
My research shows that you can take digital footprints that we are all leaving behind while using digital products and services, such as your search queries, websites that you have visited, Facebook likes, tweets, emails, logs of your credit card, and use computer algorithms to translate those digital footprints into very accurate predictions of intimate traits, such as personality, intelligence, political views, sexual orientation, and also future behavior, such as what you're going to buy or whom you are likely to vote for. So what about politicians trying to manipulate people?
Persuasion audiences, people who need shifting a little bit from the center towards the right.
If I can personalize my message and talk with people directly using separate messages, it also allows me to maybe, you know, lie to some people in one way, maybe lie to some other people in another way, or maybe just tell a group of people I will increase the taxes and the other group of people that I will decrease the taxes. So basically spread some inconsistent pieces of information.
I am gross and perverted. I'm obsessed and deranged. I have existed for years, but very little has changed. I'm the tool of the government and industry too.
Perhaps we should have rules as society, legal rules, cultural norms that regulate what is okay and what is not.
And regulate you. I may be vile and pernicious, but you can't look away. I make you think I'm delicious with the stuff that I say. I'm the best you can get. Have you guessed me?
Dark strategy, the micro-targeting of voters, and fragmentation of the political offer. This has become something for political campaigns, foreign powers, and data-driven consultancies to exploit.
In the context of behavioral marketing, there is no way of actually protecting the privacy of people who are being targeted.
Now, who's here? He's a psychologist. In 2008, working at the University of Cambridge, he was doing some research and he put out this questionnaire, and it was a personality test. He was trying to gather data and he put it on social media and he thought, fingers crossed, I hope this works. If I'm lucky, I'll get a couple hundred people doing my personality test because I do need a reasonable size data set. And he got over 1 million. okay? And 40% of the people who did the personality test had no problem at all in sharing their Facebook profile with their personal details. And so he knew almost half the time who the people were, all about them. Now, once word got around what an incredible data set that he had, this is gold for people who are interested in statistical analysis. Word got around and somebody came knocking on the door. His name was Alexander Cogan, and he was representing a company called SCL. They're the parent company of Cambridge Analytica. So SCL have been working for the government, the military. What do they specialize in? Behavior modification of populations. Spying, analysis, persuasion. Sorting people into personality types for the Trump election. According to their personality, they got different types of persuasion put their way. So if you were an extrovert, you would get one kind of message, and if you were a conscientious, neurotic type of person, you would get something completely different. But they would both be selling you the same thing. This is actually the same message. So the first one being for high neuroticism and conscientious type, is kind of easily frightened. So you've got the fist coming through the window, and it says, defend the right to bear arms. So this is on the gun rights issue. And then on the other one, it's a close, agreeable sort. No neuroticism at all. So you can see their personalities at a glance. And so from father to son, since the birth of our nation, defend the Second Amendment. So it's the same result, but it's just a totally different style of message. It is actually called behavioural micro-targeting. That's right. That's right. What they are trying to do, as you heard him say, so people who just need a little bit of shifting further to the right, people who are undecided about their vote were the actual target for Cambridge Analytica in the United States. So they only actually worked in 17 states where there was a possibility of swaying the vote. And one of them was Wisconsin. The Democrats were so confident about Wisconsin, they didn't even go there. But Cambridge Analytica had realized there was a large number of people who could be swung. So it's really expanded now in terms of what Cambridge Analytica thinks big data is. It's information about where you are geographically, the traditional demographics that campaigns, political parties have always been using. And then we've got the psychographic information now that comes in about your lifestyle, and then finally the personality, where it's not Big Brother, because Big Brother was only watching. This creature is inside your head, actually, persuading you what to do. SCL has been doing this for over 25 years, and now Cambridge Analytica, on their website, they say they have over 25 years' experience. They share resources, staff, offices, and, a hinterland.
Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana.
Daylight come and me one go home.
Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana.
Daylight come and me one go home.
I should tell you that Michael Kaczynski, when this guy Alexander Cogan came to visit him, he wanted to buy the data set. And the psychologist, a very nice guy, he said, what do you want to use it for?
SCL Group provides data, analytics, and strategy to governments and military organizations worldwide. For over 25 years, we have conducted behavioral change programs in over 60 countries and have been formally recognized for our work in defense and social change.
And when he found out, Kaczynski said, no way, this is personal. I mean, people confided their personal details to me, but I'm not going to pass them on to you. And if you look at Australian privacy laws, that's exactly what we should do here. I researched that a lot. During the Q&A, if you want, I can answer questions about privacy. I don't have time to go into that during my talk. So what did Kogan do? He set up another company and put out the personality test questionnaires again on Facebook, and everybody offered up their data again. So in fact, what they were able to do was to know the identity of the personalities. And then, of course, in America, you can buy any information you like. Americans have almost no control whatsoever over the privacy of their data. They've got an automatic opt-out of privacy, whereas in Europe, it's an automatic opt-in, right? Americans have to buy their privacy. In Australia, we're close to Europe, somewhere in between. But we've got to be careful, because I'm just going to give you, I'm going to drop a bomb right now, because Cambridge Analytica set up an office in Maroubra this year. They registered an Australian branch last year in September 2016, and they've been advertising. I don't know if there's any good IT people here. If you want to go and work for them, that I'm sure they pay you a fortune, but you'd have to be good. So on the day Donald Trump was elected president of the United States, the CEO of a small and relatively unknown British company, Cambridge Analytica, announced, "We are thrilled that our revolutionary approach to data-driven communications played such an integral part in President-elect Donald Trump's extraordinary win." Cambridge Analytica was also behind the Brexit campaign. Holy shit! Echoed around the aisles and the globe. We had been preparing ourselves for something other than what happened. Anyone recognize the typeface? That's from Hillary's book. Yesterday.
I'm pretty sure Hillary Clinton will be elected president, and I'm pretty sure the Republicans will do everything they can to sabotage her capacity to govern.
As election day draws near, Clinton will be hailed as the first female president, regardless of her crimes and lies.
So I'm pretty sure we're going to have stalemate government for another 4 years at least.
My analysis is that Trump would not be permitted to win.
I interviewed Lessig in Iceland. I filmed Pilcher in Sydney, and I just grabbed the Pilcher interview with Assange. You have all three predicting with absolute certainty that Hillary is going to win the election. They weren't the only ones.
Even the Russians thought Hillary was going to win. According to their website, the Russian Institute for Strategic Studies is a major scientific and analytical center established by Putin. It analyzes and predicts trends in political and socio-economic processes at global and regional levels. According to US officials, RIS issued a warning late in the campaign that Clinton was going to win the election. They allegedly suggested the Kremlin abandon the previous plan, which was to encourage US voters to elect a president who would take a softer line towards Russia and focus now on voter fraud to undermine the US electoral system's legitimacy. Such are the claims. So if that's true, what happened that almost everyone got it wrong? The meteoric rise of Ted Cruz from obscurity to runner-up for the Republican nomination in a few months may not have seemed significant at the time. It was. Cruz found Cambridge Analytica first, and all of the user data that was harvested for his highly successful campaign was then channeled into Trump's.
So big data is very large, supersized data sets that may be analyzed selectively, to reveal patterns, trends, and associations, especially relating to human behavior and interaction. So what kind of data can that be? Well, we're quite used to, quite at ease with anonymous statistics. There's a lot of things that we vote upon that can be completely anonymous. Beyond that, we've got our digital footprint. This is everywhere that we go online. It's our browsing, our emails, the digital footprint that we left behind. And that is more or less identifiable. Everybody's got a unique address for their physical device. So it depends on the laws, the privacy laws of each country, as to who actually gets access to that. Of course, intelligence agencies, police, if necessary, ASIO, would have access if there was a reason to do so. Deo,
deo, be like a man, me one go.
It really does change from one country to another, so one has to be aware of the privacy laws. So there's also the information that we offer freely on social media without really thinking that we're publishing. And sometimes that can get us into trouble. The thing is, we do reveal a lot of things about what's going on inside our head these days. Michael Kaczynski, the guy you heard speaking at first, has moved on to something else. He's moved on to detecting personality traits from facial recognition. That is very, very scary.
Is there any link between the facial appearance thing you said before and the current federal governments wanting to profile everyone under the terrorism new laws where they take your face to see if you turn up? There is a link.
Well, there's a potential. There's a potential. The technology has certainly been developed by Kaczynski and other people. Kaczynski's already published very recently. It's really chilling. And the problem is always, there's an old saying in IT, garbage in, garbage out. So if the assumptions are wrong, and this can happen a lot with crime, there's a lot of crime watch of black neighborhoods in the United States. And it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. They find crime because they never stop watching for it. Kaczynski had discovered that with Facebook likes, he could tell an awful lot about somebody. In terms of what could be predicted about what these people would do, more than they knew themselves. So then there's real-world information about individuals, and that's kind of restricted too. People's credit records and things that they purchase. So using big data, what does this change in our world? Well, it changes a couple of things, two things that are really quite significant. It changes the way that we do statistical analysis. We used to approach a big data set with hypothesis, and we'd use our information to test the hypothesis. So what happens now when you've got these enormous trillions of bits of information, you just throw it all in and just wait and see for emergent correlations. So that's kind of interesting because we can move a lot faster and we can get things that we don't expect to emerge from large data sets. Something else that has changed is political and marketing strategy.
I'm very much of the belief that blanket advertising is dead.
And so communications in the 21st century are moving away from the single megaphone that talks to the whole population with maybe a catch cry or a slogan for a campaign, it's time, and hope that everybody likes it, hope everybody engages with it. But now, in fact, what happens is, you know, people can be contacted directly. They can receive messages on the right-hand column of their Facebook wall, and nobody else sees that. It's a bit of a dangerous thing. So people are studied, the right messages are constructed, and then those whispers go in people's ears individually. And I think that poses a bit of a problem for democracy. Certainly, psychometrics trumps, pardon the pun, demographics. There are some really, really good reasons to acquire information about people's tastes.
Positive examples of using algorithms to discover people's psychological traits include better job matching, better psychological diagnosis, better ability to maybe match people for the purpose of working on a team or maybe even starting a romantic relationship. advising you what books or movies you may want to read, making sure that our education is personalized. You could keep the core curriculum, but then make sure that you build on the specific talents and interests of every individual child to let them excel and build on their strengths.
Even education can be tailor-made to specific children so that they work at their own pace. So there's lots of good reasons, as long as you don't cross the line and use it for the wrong reasons, and that's just to get a vote and to say whatever it takes to get that vote.
This phenomenon was about much more than just a few fake news stories. It was a piece of a much bigger and darker puzzle, a weaponized AI propaganda machine being used to manipulate our opinions and behavior to advance specific political agendas. By leveraging automated emotional manipulation alongside swarms of bots, Facebook dark posts, A/B testing, and fake news networks, a company called Cambridge Analytica has activated an invisible machine that preys on the personalities of individual voters to create large shifts in public opinion. Many of these technologies have been used individually to some effect before, but together they make up a nearly impenetrable voter manipulation machine that is quickly becoming the new deciding factor in elections around the world. Barrett Anderson, The Rise of the Weaponized AI Propaganda Machine.
Let's talk a little bit about psychometrics. So, psychometrics is the measurement of people's knowledge and their abilities and their attitudes and their personality. More than anything else, their personality.
It is personality that informs decision making, and clearly your decisions will drive the way that you vote.
Why should two people of the same age, the same ethnicity, living in the same street, the same gender, why should they get the same message? Pine was talking about this on Q&A. He just received a presentation down in Melbourne from Cambridge Analytica and was very impressed. So Trump and Farage are very impressed too, because using this technique has been extremely successful. So what does it involve? Now, it's the ocean personality testing. It's the big five. People are measured. O is how open are people to new experience. How conscientious are people? Do they just like things not to change? They like things to be orderly. Extroversion, all right? We all know what that means. Social, spend time with others. Agreeableness, do you put other people's needs before your own? Yeah? And finally, neuroticism. How easily are you frightened? People would get different scores, and then they were sorted into groups. All the people who had the same profiles were delivered the same messaging. This woman is 25 to 30, single, mid-income, daily coffee drinker, active on Facebook. Look at her personality. She's very neurotic. So, in fact, the ad that they sent her is about having stained teeth. Right? And look, she's advertising just loves this, and big money is being invested now in employing psychologists. And all of these huge advertising companies are using them. On September 22nd, 2016, The Times reported that a company with six PhD-level data scientists would be used to target 20 million new voters for Donald Trump. And at the helm would be Alexander Nix, a 40-year-old former Etonian who had promised to revolutionize the political landscape.
When Cambridge Analytica, my firm, joined the Trump campaign, there were only 30 full-time employees on the campaign, which is in stark contrast to the Clinton campaign, which had somewhere close to 800 people working on it. Google undertook an independent brand lift study to understand the impact of our work. Google reported that the people who received targeted communications responded 18% in terms of the uplift through search volume. This manifested itself in an 11% increase in favorability and an 8% in voter intent for Trump. Communication is getting ever more individualized. A husband and a wife in the same household can receive different communications, even if they're from the same company and on the same product. We can use cookies in order to identify and engage the densest possible audiences for specific messages. In America, we can also take offline target segments and match them to set-top box viewing data.
Why should people give you those complex information in order to you make an ocean profile?
There's no reason why people should give up any data at all, and there's certainly no obligation to. We've managed to collect millions of ocean profiles in the United States by people volunteering this information to us. We can then match these ocean profiles against the data attributes that we hold on those individuals who've taken these personality inventories. Now, in other countries, we don't have this vast insight. We would have to collect it. And whether people wish to give up this information, of course, is entirely up to them.
Once you open Pandora's box and put all this information online, you can't really pull it back.
The sooner we accept the fact that privacy is not going to be there, and the sooner we start talking about how to make sure that the post-privacy society is still a safe, habitable, and nice place to live, the better for all of us.
Are you happy putting a misogynist buffoon who's now fucking up our world?
Look, I'm going to hand it over to Max. Actually, shall I give you the spoiler before I end it?
Yes.
Cambridge Analytica being sued. Landmark case. So, a guy in New York, he's a professor at a school of design and communications, and in fact, they made a fatal mistake because they processed everyone's data for the Trump campaign in England. It processed it in London. It doesn't matter who the data's about, but where it was processed. And so they've really slipped up and they've violated European privacy laws.
Give me your dirty love, like you might surrender to some dragon in your dream. Give me your dirty love, like a pink donation to the dragon in your dream. I don't need your sweet devotion, and I don't want your cheap emotion.
Whip me up some dragon lotion for your dirty love, your dirty love.
Give me your dirty love, like some tacky little pamphlet in your daddy's bottom drawer. Give me your dirty love, I don't believe you never seen his book before. I don't need no consolation, I don't want your reservation. I only got one destination, and that's your dirty love, your dirty love.
It looks like a dump. It really does.